This week we're going to be talking about making predictions. This is going to be a big part of this course, and we'll introduce a lot of concepts that we'll see again later. Loss functions, training sets, testing sets, and more. I'm thankful to be joined today by my former student He, who is now faculty at New York University, who will help explain all of this to us. So what exactly are we going to be predicting?
We're going to be predicting real numbers today.
And what are we going to be predicting those real numbers from?
A set of other real numbers.
To phrase this in terms of mathematical concepts, this means we're going to be predicting a scalar y from a scalar x?
Let's start there. For real applications, you'd probably want to have model inputs, which makes it a little more complicated. For example, to predict a child's height, you may want their age and gender, two inputs, to make the prediction. But let's see what the mass looks like with just one input.
Okay, so it looks like we have an intercept term, beta naught, plus a linear term that's multiplied by the input x. For this one-dimensional case, it's a line mapping your x's to your y's.
Exactly. This is called a regression line. Let's see what happens when you have multiple inputs. Sometimes these are called features in the machine learning literature or covariates in the statistical literature.
The sum there looks a lot like a dot product.
Right, that's another way you can think about it. You have a vector representing each example and a weight vector representing the regression model. Or the thing that makes the prediction. So then to make a prediction, you just take the dot product of the weight vector and the example.
And then you add the intercept beta, not, right?
Yeah, that's kind of ugly. So we often just assume that every example has one dimension, that's always one. It makes the notation a little easier. This is what it looks like when inputs are a vector rather than a scalar. You have a high number of dimensions, and now instead of line, we have a plane as our prediction function.
Okay, so at the bottom, you have two features, x1 and x2. These are a two-dimensional vector, and how high this plane is represents the prediction given the vector input.
Exactly, but normally we don't just have two dimensions. You can do things like feature engineering on regression inputs. You can transform your data, take the log, multiply things by themselves. You can have indicators that just say, does the value fall within a range? You can have interactions. So you can do lots of stuff with the input to create new ways of encoding your data. Because of its simplicity and flexibility, this is one of the most widely implemented ways of analyzing continuous data.
Yeah, there are a lot of memes out there saying that deep learning and AI are just a fancy way of saying that we're doing regression. What do you think about that?
It's true that much of deep learning builds on regression. That's why we're starting to talk about it first. And it's also true that many things that are called AI or deep learning could probably be solved by a regression model with good features and enough data.
So there's nothing to the hype? If I only care about natural language, there's no reason to study this?
Well, I didn't say that. We'll get to stuff that regression cannot do, but that will require nonlinearities and multiple layers of predictions. But it's important to start with regression over continuous outputs to understand the basic concepts that we'll build on later. For instance, in the next video, we may have discrete outputs.
I think I'm missing the big picture. How does this fit into prediction? Like, I want to make money on the stock market, predict an election or something like that.
Right, let's talk about the overall pipeline of feeder models. So you have some training data, you feed a model on the training data, then you make predictions on new data. When you're building a model, you do this fairly often to validate your model. This is called validation data. Then at the very end, and only once, you apply your model to test data. As far as you're concerned, these examples have the same mathematical form as the training data. But while the training data have both x and y's, the test data doesn't have a y.
Okay, so how does that prediction work?
You take an input example, take the dot product with a model parameter, and then you get an answer. This is your prediction for that example. This is the last time we'll have the explicit beta naught. From now on, we'll just have the dot product of the vectors beta and x. Remember, you can always just make one dimension of x always be one, and it's the same thing.
Let's try to do a prediction at x equals 5. You multiply it by 0.5 or 1 half, and then add 1. So it's now 3.5. I guess geometrically, you find the place on this x-axis, then you go up, and you see where it hits the line, in this case 3.5. Okay, so this is how you do predictions, but thus far we've just been assuming that we have a model. Where does the model itself come from?
Okay, here's the key equation. This is called the residual sum of squares. Let's go through each of those components. Residual just means how wrong your prediction is. The dot product of beta and x is from the right answer yi.
The square is just then taking the square of that residual.
And then you sum it all together.
What's the one half thing?
Oh, it makes the derivative work out nicely, but it's a linear term, so you can ignore it and get the same result.
You mentioned derivatives. Does that mean we'll be optimizing this function by walking up and down gradients like we talked about before?
That's usually what we do, yes. But one of the things that makes linear regression special is we don't even have to do that. Normally, what we do is we have a loss function or objective function. In this case, the RSS. You try to minimize the objective function to find the best answer. And yes, usually you do gradient search to find the answer. This, however, is called a closed form solution and makes our life really easy. There's one solution and the math works out that you can just compute the answer.
We've been talking about probabilities a lot in this class, but you haven't talked about probabilities once yet.
You don't have to think about regression as probabilistic, but you can. The probabilistic interpretation is that the y's are drawn from a Gaussian distribution, whose mean is the dot product of x and beta. So you can think about that as having a Gaussian curve at every point where the center of the Gaussian curve is the output or your prediction.
I guess there is a resemblance between the equations, the RSS and the Gaussian PDF.
Exactly. And Gauss, the namesake of the Gaussian distribution, developed a regression to understand the orbit of the asteroid Ceres. So it's not a coincidence. That's it for today. Next time, we'll be talking about classification, which has an even stronger probabilistic formulation.
If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.